Thank you all so much for listening and sharing and asking questions. Please keep that energy up. You're here to learn, those attending live and those. So thank you so much. And next up, we have Priya. Priya is going to bring her perspective from Google about API management from a network engineer's perspective, from use cases in the field. It should be very interesting. Thank you, Priya.
Hi, everyone. And I think just on the other side, this session is more on the ecosystem rather than the actual API implementation itself. So I'll, I think today's session, I would like to, you know, first introduce myself. I have been a network engineer for almost, you know, developer plus a network engineer for almost 16 years now. So I started my journey with a lot of low-level kernel programming, networking, and slowly I moved into the API space. Now, because of my background in networking, I am placing my expertise into designing an architecture for enterprises who wants to use API management. Now, my perspective comes from my enterprise customers, my fintech customers, from Google Cloud, but it can be applied to any other use case. So although I'll be speaking with respect to my experience, but I would really say, I'll share my screen for you. So I'll really say that, you know, you are not limited to Google Cloud with this. You're not limited to the products which are used at Google Cloud. You can very well, you know, use these learnings and do it in your own API management system, your own, you know, cloud or data on-prem, whatever you have. So I think this would be a slightly different session to what you are used to in API days, because this is more about the ecosystem around an API management product. So for example, I work heavily with the Google Cloud's APG, API management platform, but my positioning is way before they start implementing APIs. For me, it's more of where do they place this? How do they secure it from with all the other products we have in cloud today? And then comes, you know, second phase saying now you have to design your APIs. So I would say, you know, we'll focus this more on that basic of what goes before somebody starts developing a proxy or developing an API management system. So as I said, I'm a regional lead and I work heavily with Europe customers, but I also work with America and JPAC customers. And most of the experience which I'm going to share now will be based on how I saw it, especially with the banking industry, because they have banking, as we all know, really strict security requirements, really strict compliance requirements. So I'll be sharing some of my learnings on the way, what I feel that, you know, this is how a design would look good. So as I said, we are going a step, a step before actual API. So instead of getting into that API zone, we want to take a bigger picture. Okay, what is around API management, which makes it more secure, more performant, efficient. So we will be treating API management as a black box for now. So this is that level stage before we actually go for implementing. So we will discuss about network, how network influences how your, because finally your customer and your backend, all this goes for securing and making good performance between your customer request goes to the backend, comes back like a response. And in between, what all can we do to make it as secure as possible, as smart, predictable as possible, as performance resilience wise, how can we make it better? So we'll discuss about networking concepts, slightly dive into those. We'll discuss about what kind of security goes around it, what performance impacts, like latency. Latency is a big problem. If somebody gets a, you know, response in few seconds, it's not a good product. Even if the code is really good, if that is killing your users are waiting, it's no good. So we are going to talk about how these things, so you can imagine these as, you know, future of API management, how is it evolving? API management ecosystem, how is it evolving? So we'll discuss about network, security, performance, reliability, because, you know, failovers, regional downtime, this is a huge, huge issue. Most of the time, like recently there was some, I can't name the customer, but there was someone in JPAC where the downtime was more, and now they are moving to the product which we are suggesting. So these things act a lot when you are designing your API management ecosystem. And finally, we'll touch on AI and multi-cloud, because those are very much part of where the industry is going. How can AI influence API management? How can multi-cloud, how can you know, API management be on multiple clouds, whether it is data center, on-premise, Google Cloud, AWS, Azure. This has to work together. So we'll touch base on all these points in the session today. So coming to the most important question, whenever I go for a new customer, trust me, first few weeks are all about this. It's all about, this is our security requirement. This is our compliance requirement. How do you do this? So I will, again, I'm talking to you with what I work on, which is Google Cloud. But again, feel free to relate it to any other product you might have in your company today where you want to use this. So first of all comes, if your client or your customer, say a mobile app, you're designing an API for some application, which is triggering an API and getting a response back, but they are external users. They are using it from their mobile phone, say online banking, something like that. So in these cases, you have to be very sure that even before your request is going to your API management software, in my case, it will be APG. Even before it goes there has to be multiple layers of security to make sure it's a genuine request. It's not like a DDoS attack. It's not something which an intruder is trying to get into your API management, access that particular software. So for that, we usually position something like Cloud Armor, which is a WAF kind of product. And then again, there are many more products out in the market which do similar job. So we position that saying, first, it has to go through that layer. Then comes an identity management, access management. Say, who is authorized, who is authenticated, and not just to the API platform, but to each of your, say, you have designed your proxies, say, 2 or 3 proxies. It also depends who has access to proxy 1, who has access to your proxy 2. So this is a very fine-grained control of who has what role and who is allowed to access that particular backend. So this comes as another layer. And the third thing we would suggest is, you know, having something like VPC service controls. Now, this is specific to Google Cloud, this terminology, but again, you can use it for other equivalent products. This is mainly for making sure that who is able to extract the data or call the APIs out of your network. So you're really having a perimeter around those core resources or core software where you want very strict access, right? So not everybody. So this is like another layer of having a perimeter around your secure data or securing your workloads, your backends. So this again is another layer we can add into this when we are designing. And reCAPTCHA is one more feature which is more on fraud detection, because fraud detection is like if somebody is logging into an online banking account. This has to be one of those parameters where we are checking it even before the request reaches your application code. Then comes data loss prevention. This is again something which we insist to have because it has a lot of features for sensitive data. So these are all cloud DLP reCAPTCHA, not really mandatory for any implementation, but this is what we say, you know, this is a best practice. Try to adopt as many of these as possible because there's no, you know, we can't just say this one thing is enough for me. We want to have as many layers of security as possible. And finally, CMEC is again customer managed encryption keys. That is for encrypting the requests, the responses, what is coming into your software and what is going out of it. And this can be stored in any region. So these are few of the layers we propose when it comes to security and privacy. And then comes the importance of having some kind of AI-powered automation. So there are a lot of tools available which can inspect historic data. For example, it's like Black Friday. If you have Black Friday or if you have some really peak season where you expect a lot of traffic to come through, API management itself, like APG itself, has those spike arrest capabilities, which are okay to filter the spike to make sure that it's not really, you know, flooding your backends. Apart from that, AI powered automation can be used to predict what is possible based on historic data. You might have some data of how many requests came through, how many customers logged in this particular season. And based on that, it can predict the traffic that is, you know, making you well aware that, okay, this is expected to be. So maybe you want to scale your infra at that time. You want to have more capacity so that, you know, you're not really overloaded. Instead of one instance, you want to replicate it. So that is one thing, prediction. And then even anomaly identification. Now, these all are really good when it comes to when you have some historic data, then these things come into picture. And you know, just to ensure that you are compliant and you're not really up to a surprise saying, okay, now what do I do? This today we have so many users logged in. So these are all the things which are, again, they can help. They can help in fine-tuning that API management itself. Now, coming to, again, performance, reliability, global reach, what we suggest is, because Google Cloud has 24 regions and many cache locations, it's highly recommended that, you know, you can deploy your APIs in multiple regions, and it's recommended to deploy it in more than one, just to have that, you know, disaster recovery or HA-related requirements. And then maximize your API reach globally, because, again, when we go to the customer, Google Cloud is one of the primary features of Google Cloud is that it's a global network. So it's automatically, it can switch over, and there's a lot we can do using Google's networking capabilities. So we do recommend customers to make use of that, store the data in your region of choice. And again, for low latency, if at all there is a requirement that your backends are taking a long time to process, or you want really low latency, then even we recommend customers to deploy APG in a hybrid fashion. Saying that, so there is one product which is like SaaS, totally in the cloud, totally managed by Google, all that. But there is another version of it, because, you know, going to the cloud, coming back might add latency. And if your application is very strict on the latency requirements, then you can also have your runtime on your premise, so that it doesn't have that, you know, lag time between going to the cloud, getting a response back. It can also happen locally on your on-premise system. So I think with hybrid architecture, we recommend it either for low latency, or if it is multi-cloud, or if there is security requirement. If your security team does not want your request and response to go to a cloud infrastructure, then you can have it on-premise. So it's all in your data center. So these are the ones we recommend for this. Now I'll take you through a sample architecture. And again, I have a reference link here in the bottom. You can go through it, and it's a really good explanation. So I'll take you through one architecture, which we start from the scratch, blank sheet, and then we progress on how we build it up. So coming to this, if you see the leftmost column, the green one, these are, think of them as your consumers, maybe a mobile or app user or something. Then comes, this is the pink box here. This is mainly your API management product. So in my case, I'm taking example of APIGX. You can have any other product. Now, between these, we really want to enforce these all security capabilities and all, which I spoke about, somewhere before the request can reach your API management product. So this is where in Google Cloud, we have a totally isolated networks, two totally isolated networks, so that without your notice or your permission, without configuring this, nothing can reach your actual system, your API management software. So after this, we say that, and one more main advantage of this is you're not exposing your SaaS product or your, publicly, we are not exposing any public IP. So earlier, there are many products which directly customers can log into this. Now that opens up a port and IP on your API management product itself. We don't want that. We want it to go through a certain layers of security before it can go here. So there's no public IP, which is a big win for a security team. The more you lock down these public interfaces, the better it is. Now coming to the next stage, this is what in the previous stage we described this. This is internally how we do it. It will be like a load balancer. It will be a NAT on the backend. And then finally to your backend systems, the request goes from here to here. And within this, we say that now when we want to talk to this, we say something like VPC network peering. Network peering is a concept, again, Google Cloud, we use it heavily. That is to enable communication between two separate networks in Google Cloud. We call it virtual private cloud networks. So here we say that, okay, network peering is the way where you can hear anyone, any application or any software running here can access it through this peering connection. But again, this is not exposed directly to the outside world. Now, what we do after that is, because we want some, like I spoke about Cloud Armor, I spoke about global load balancers. So now we have those as the frontline security layer, saying this is a load balancer. First thing, it will load balance. It will not make your one, even if one region goes down, it will automatically switch over to the other region. If you have one in Belgium, one in, say, Frankfurt, you want Belgium to be primary, Frankfurt to be secondary. That's all handled here in this layer. And this is exposing an external IP address. And this is again paired up with Cloud Armor. It has a lot of capabilities to stop those unnecessary, you know, intrusion type of threats. It has a lot of capabilities around that DDoS protection. So that's why we recommend having this as your front layer. Then through this, it goes through, again, based on what kind of other requirements you have. You might need a mutual TLS, you might need one-way TLS, or you need another VM where we want to deploy an additional software to check or terminate the connections here. So all these are possible in this pattern, wherein your request, consumer request comes through your load balancers with some, you know, Cloud Armor capabilities, checks there. Then goes to your VM. Again, you can set up any Nginx server, anything here which you feel like you need that additional layer of security, or you want to stop the terminate the TLS connection there. So whatever you want to do here, and then it goes to the actual Apigee instance from there to the backend. So as you can see, there are like multiple layers which a request has to hop through to be able to reach the backend. Now, these, again, don't put a lot of latency because these are really, these are meant to be used in this way. So without latency, we are trying to make it more secure. Coming to the internal workload, say if you have your own customer applications which you don't want to go through this, then they can directly access because they are in that trusted zone. They are already in the zone where you know that it's not like an outsider. It's within the within your own network. So for any on-premise, your data center calls or these, they can go directly here. And then if you see, yeah, that's what we are emphasizing. And again, these are like internal IP addresses, so we can trust them. So it need not go through these heavy security inspection layers. So it can directly access your runtime. So if you have an internal user or internal developer who is trying to reach to that API runtime, then you can directly go there, and then even a on-premise connections can be direct without going through this heavy load balancing and other WAF capabilities. Now, coming to the whole life cycle, so like this one, a consumer triggers an API call. They want to just have a request. So their request packet goes from here, goes through the load balancer, depending on which is the active region or based on the load balancer configuration. It will then reach the VM images, which are again in the cloud. Here, again, after another layer of security, this goes over this peered network to your internal load balancer again, which reaches to the Apigee instance. Now, this is where your headers will be passed, your policies, your whatever proxy code you have implemented. That will be applied. And from there, it goes through an egress NAT to your backend. Now, this backend can be it can be an application running on your cloud itself. It can be an application running on a separate cloud, maybe AWS, maybe Azure, or it can also be an application running on-premise. So it can be anything, but once the request is through this, we are, you know, it's actually been worked on. So all the policies other than API management, other security aspects are also applied to it. And then the response goes back to the main customer. Now, it doesn't go back, need not have to go back through this channel again. It goes back to the main customer. But yeah, this is the whole life cycle of how the different stages where we implement this. Now, as a final note, I would like to, you know, point you to a Git repo. Now, here is where with all pattern which I've shown, that is like one pattern which we usually, you know, recommend based on the customer requirements. But there are many more patterns which, depending on whether it's an internal user, external user, what kind of backend it is, what layers of security are needed, there are many more patterns which we have promoted. And all these patterns, to make it easy, we are trying to convert them into deployable scripts so that you have a pattern, you have a script to play around with, understand what it does, and it should be easy for you to just configure it, take it, deploy it, and you are good to go. So whatever we showed here, the whole pattern, the team in Google, we are working on, and this is open source, so anybody can, you know, anyone is free to use it, and Daniel, he's the lead driving it. So we will be committing a lot of sample scripts in this, which will adhere to those best practices which we internally, and again, you know, our best practices are based on learnings from different customers. So you can make use of that and use these scripts to just go on with your deployment. If you're using Google Cloud, if you're using Apigee, then I would really recommend you to go check out this Git repo, check which patterns you need, and there will be a README file or, you know, some instructions to follow. And if you have any issues, if you want to see anything else any other requirements you have, you can raise it. And we have a team who is working on this particular repo, and we want to make it easy for everyone, not just, you know, the customers who are going through Google Cloud. So I think with that, I'm almost at time. So I'll leave you with that. Here is my LinkedIn access. If in case you have any questions, then please feel free to call and ping me on this.
Thank you so much, Priya. So thank you so much, Priya. That was really interesting. Is this something, these best practices and patterns only work if you're using Google Cloud and Apigee together? Do a lot of these best practices and patterns really apply across all of the ecosystem?
Yeah, I think I can't really suggest for other products. I'm not experienced enough, honestly, but I would say, you know, every other provider also has equivalent products. So these concepts can be used at other places. If you're using Google Cloud and Apigee, definitely it's ready to use. You take the pattern, you take the scripts, deploy them. But others also should have something equivalent.
How do you communicate this learning that went into developing this product? How did this code, we love that it's open source, so of course you have feedback from the community, but how did you reach this point when the team started recognizing these patterns and the anti-patterns?
It's honestly months and months of you know, experience, because we came up with these challenges. Customer said, what if we need this? What if we need? So not just me, there's a whole team, and all our customer-facing engineers have worked on developing this Bible. We call it internally, it's like Bible for patterns. I've showed you one pattern, and we are trying to publish others on Google website as well. Currently it's internal, but we are trying to see which patterns we can publish. We have some 60, 70 patterns. And each pattern has its own, you know, what do you get with this? What do you lose with this? And again, it's also different requirements come in. So we are planning to publish that. Most likely, if I have another talk next time, you'll be seeing the link to the publicly facing patterns website. But for now, I think I can say it's a brain dump from hundreds of engineers working every day.
Absolutely. But how do they get the time to actually write down and think about? Is this part of your agile process where you review it in retrospectives, or how do they, you make sure that developers have that time space to think about it?
Yeah, I think we have this called professional services organization. I belong to that. So development team is different. Engineering team is different. We are engineers who are customer facing. So our time is dedicated. We are like solution architects. So our time is dedicated to bringing up these patterns, which can be reused easily. So, of course, this is like a part of what we do every day. We learn requirements, we design something, and then we generalize it. So that although I'm doing it for X bank, say XYZ, whoever it is, I want to generalize it so that it can be used in other places as well. So, I would say we have a big organization who deserve a job to get good patterns out, which adhere to best practices, plus gives the customer easy way to deploy.
That's important. And it all comes down to a lot of customer feedback and a lot of employee feedback. Yeah. Thank you so much, Priya. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your API days.
Thank you. Thank you.